preserve the distance to the subject, but also to discredit this social phenomenon. Since the 1990s, conspiracy theories became increasingly a subject of social science, but mainly in the tradition of previous work. From this perspective, conspiracy theories conceptually are considered to be an illegitimate form of knowledge, because they claim to show to know something about conspiracies which does not exist in reality. From this point of view, conspiracy theories seem to be problematic in a triple sense. First, it is claimed that conspiracy theories are based on false knowledge, unproven allegations, or invented suspicions. Second, it is assumed that the belief in a conspiracy theory suggests doubt on the mental health of the believer. And third, conspiracy theories are problematic because they are a political threat. From this point of view, conspiracy theories are the base for irrational political extreme attitudes and therefore political menace. According to this review, conspiracy theories appear as a kind of social disease that must be treated. So it is not surprising that the discussed possible causes of conspiracy theories in the majority of scientific studies are provided in a problematizing, negative, or even pathologizing context. The following list gives an overview of various approaches discussed to explain the emergence and spread of conspiracy theories. Hofstetter speaks about paranoid style as a cause of conspiracy theories. Popper calls conspiracy theories a secularization of religious superstition. Other authors speak about distrust, fear, feelings of futility and helplessness, obedience to authority, low self-esteem and discrimination as reasons for belief in conspiracy theories. Daniel Pipe, another important author, wrote in terms of conspiracy theories how the paranoid style flowers and where it comes from. Dieter Koh, a German historian, describes structural elements of clinical paranoia as an explanatory model for collective conspiracy theories. Some authors discuss pathogenic disorders in early childhood, parent-child relationship as reasons for the belief in conspiracy theories. And finally, it is often discussed that, that a conspiracy mentality is a product of an authoritarian personality or of confusion and disorientation in phases of crisis. All these diagnoses have in common that they are characterized by the understanding of conspiracy theories as an illegitimate and problematic knowledge. The axiomic assumption that conspiracy theories are always factually false is usually already expressed in the base definition of the individual scientific authors writing about conspiracy theories. Daniel Pipes, for example, argues that in a sense, conspiracy theory is simply a conspiracy that never happened, that is non-existent version of a conspiracy. That means that conspiracy theories are completely wrong and imaginary from the outset. Based on this premise, these theoretical explanations focus primarily on the reconstruction of inherent structural features of conspiracy theories by which the cognitive deficiency of conspiracy theory thinking can be demonstrated. So conspiracy theories are principal subject to an epistemic naivety. From this point of view, conspiracy theories are monocausal, outwardly completed and simplified explanations that reduce complex events to manageable interpretations. Without a doubt, the problematic aspects of conspiracy theories should deserve a special consideration in scientific analysis in conspiracy thinking. Nevertheless, that's a point I want to underline. The fixation on these aspects lead to a one-sided perspective. David Cody, an US-American philosopher, verbalized this as follows. I will argue that although many conspiracy theories are flawed, this does not justify such dismissive attitudes. While it is true that excessive willingness to believe conspiracy theory is an intellectual bias, it is also true that excessive reluctance to believe them is an actual vice. So conspiracy theories have not only negative but also positive potential. From my perspective, it makes it too easy if one examines only the negative conspiracy theories contain much more than this. We will not develop a comprehensive understanding of this phenomenon if we don't examine all these aspects that go with it. For this, we need a neutral perspective that does not reject conspiracy theories a priori as paranoid nonsense. And this brings me to the next part of my speech. I will try to give a new perspective on conspiracy theories based on sociology of knowledge. From this specific view, the approaches to conspiracy theories I mentioned are analytically misguided. If you want to analyze a particular form of social knowledge, it does not make any sense to define this knowledge as false or illegitimate knowledge from the outset. So I would make it would make no sense to define Catholicism as nonsense if you want to analyze and understand why so many people are Catholics. Behind the mentioned approaches are specific ideas of psychological and political norms that are always socially determined and therefore cannot be generalized. The fundamental problem of such essentialist approaches on conspiracy theories is that they implicitly or explicitly take over common sense classifications of mass media. However, within the mass media, the term conspiracy theory is not used in a scientific way. In the public discourse, the term conspiracy theory is rather used as a rhetorical device to stigmatize and discredit dissenting options. In other words, the term conspiracy theory and the associated attributions are always a part of the fight for the power to define social reality. Whether something is considered as a fictional conspiracy theory or as a real conspiracy depends on processes of social construction of reality. This process of division into true and false does not necessarily need any objective facts. This means that conspiracy theories can be described scientifically only by a relational perspective. An important feature of conspiracy theories is that they are located in opposition to accepted constructions of reality. In terms of sociology of knowledge, one could say conspiracy theories are heterodox realities. This means that their constructions of reality is not consensus. I would like to illustrate this with an example. The conspiracy theories in terms of 9/11, their identity as a conspiracy theory obviously depends on their antagonistic relationship to the official and socially recognized conspiracy narration of the US government and the mainstream media. The relationship is significant for the current use of the term in the social and academic field. And indeed, as described by David Cody, the term conspiracy theorists have evolved to the point where it's a little more than a label for people who believe or are interested in investigating any proposition with conflict with an officially sanctioned or orthodox belief. Indeed, the expression is sometimes used by such people even when their so-called conspiracy theory does not involve any conspiracy at all. The expression conspiracy theory and conspiracy theorist are the respectable modern equivalents of heresy and heretic. These expressions serve to castigate and marginalize anyone who rejects or even questions orthodox or officially endorsed beliefs. If scientific authors take the concept and the discrediting and stigmatizing concept related to conspiracy theories out of the political arena, they reproduce the disregarding social attributions and give them a scientific character. This is a classical case of an unreflective scientific reproduction of popular opinion. In opposition to this, an approach based on sociology of knowledge has to focus on the process that divide knowledge in heterodox and orthodox forms. An important aspect of this perspective is that knowledge is always socially determined and cannot be reduced to objective facts in a positivistic sense. In relation to conspiracy theories, this means that the main question is what conditions cause that they are held as true or false by the people and the media. In terms of the definition of the term conspiracy theory that reflects considerations from the field of the sociology of knowledge, this means that the veracity of conspiracy theories cannot be determined by definition. To meet this requirement, I propose the following conceptual differentiation that can be understood as ideal types in the sense of Max Weber. A heterodox conspiracy theory is a belief system or explanatory model which describes, describes current or historical events, collective experiences, or the development of a society as a whole as the result of a conspiracy. The existence of this conspiracy is not accepted by the majority of the population, the leading media, or other important institutions. And an orthodox conspiracy theory is a belief system or explanatory model which describes current or historical events, collective experiences, or the development of a society as a whole as the result of a conspiracy. And the existence of this conspiracy is accepted by the majority of the population, the leading media, or other important institutions. As you can see, the only thing that distinguishes the two categories is their social acceptance. Which conspiracy theory is in a society at a particular historical moment regarded as heterodox and which as orthodox is a question that only can be answered empirically and not by definition. Both categories represent extreme points in an analytical continuum on which empirical cases of conspiracy theories can be positioned. Okay, in the last part of my speech, I will try to describe conspiracy theories as a special form of social knowledge. The enormous variety of conspiracy theories makes it difficult to make any general statements about them. Using the sociological perspective that is not primarily concerned with the truth and the concrete contents of conspiracy theories, some matching characteristics can be distilled that justify the approach to describe conspiracy theories as a specific form of social knowledge with its own attributes. So we can come to a general definition of conspiracy theories. A conspiracy theory is a special heterodox or orthodox form of knowledge which describes current or historical events, collective experience, or the development of a society as a whole as a result of a conspiracy. As socially constructed knowledge, conspiracy theories fulfill the function of generating subjective meaning in respect to human experiences and actions. From this perspective, the main social function of conspiracy theories is to understand events and collective experiences meaningfully, otherwise could not be integrated into existing worldviews, beliefs, or generally speaking, constructions of sense. Thus, there is no fundamental difference between orthodox and heterodox conspiracy theories. Real conspiracies and fictional conspiracies differ only by their degree of social acceptance. While the former are considered to be political reality, the latter will be rejected by the majority of members of society and the mainstream media. In other words, if there's a real conspiracy behind a conspiracy theory, it is determined in the discourse, for example, in the mass media. What is considered as a conspiracy theory today may be a real conspiracy tomorrow. What is considered as a real conspiracy today could be turned out as a conspiracy theory tomorrow. This theoretical perspective on conspiracy theories also allows basic assumptions regarding the origin of conspiracy theories. A conspiracy theory occurs when an individual or collective experiences can better be embedded in existing worldview with the assumption of a conspiracy than without. Thus, the background for the rise and spread of conspiracy theory can be, for example, a political ideology, a specific worldview, prejudice, but also a fundamental distrust of authority, a critical or skeptical attitude, or simply the common sense. Therefore, conspiracy theories have not only negative, but also quite positive potential. Provided they have a minimum level of plausibility, they are no more or less wrong than other political theories. It is absolutely important to point out the dangerous potential of conspiracy theories. They can, historical examples are sufficiently available, be used to justify totalitarian power and domination, oppression and destruction. They can generate prejudice and misconceptions about certain events, or legitimize politically extreme opinions. But they also can serve to detect real actual conspiracies, fraud or abuse of power, and disclose economic manipulations or political corruption. They can reveal secret knowledge, carry suppressed or discredited opinions, and disclose previously unknown relationships. I'm speaking therefore not only because of theoretical, but also because of socio-political reasons against the general allowance of conspiracy thinking and the associated pathologizing of the protagonists of such interpretations. The dominant public and academic thesis of a cognitive deficit is an explanation for conspiracy theories is not appropriate, not an appropriate analytical approach to this complex cultural phenomenon. Based on the described sociological contextualization of the phenomenon, there seem to be essentially five factors that have influenced the conspiracy thinking in modern times significantly. First, the cultural knowledge of the existence of real conspiracies in politics and business. It belongs to the socially accepted knowledge assets that political, military, or economic conspiracies have always influenced the course of history. Examples are the successful assassination plot against Julius Caesar in 44 before Christ, the failed assassination attempt on Adolf Hitler on 20th of July 1944, or the so-called Watergate scandal, which cost US President Nixon his office in 1974. The idea of real successful conspiracies is a basic component of our cultural knowledge and makes a variety of other conspiracies for many people possible or probable for many people. In other words, since the conspiracy is a real option for action in our cultural context, events that are influenced by humans can in principle always be interpreted as a result of conspirational action. Second, the general mistrust of parts of the population in terms of integrity and democratic attitude of political, economic, and military power elites. In recent decades, state-supported military or covert operations were repeatedly revealed, for example, the so-called Gladio affair, that had clearly no democratic legitimacy and disregarded the rule of law and ethical guidelines for state action clearly. In addition, conspiracies within economic structures were known in which the corresponding actors acted in a moral dubious or clearly criminal way. Third, the wish for plausible explanations for unexpected events in the social environment. Improbable and unexpected political and economic developments or decisions that are difficult to explain in terms of the interpretations offered by the mainstream media are generating a demand for alternative explanations. Ultimately, such alternative explanations even appear to be more equitable than the dominant reality in traditional public understanding of political, social, and economic developments. The possibility of alternative reality description appears greater. The deficit, the explanatory power of the orthodox interpretation is. In short, the strength of heterodox interpretation is caused by the weakness of orthodox descriptions. Fourth, the possibility of a largely uncontrolled circulation of opposing or heterodox beliefs and opinions through the network media. The internet allows an almost unlimited circulation of opposing interpretations. The separation between producer and consumer of media interpretations is repealed. The distribution of content is global, happens in real time, and uses social networks to generate attention for culturally undesirable or even prohibited content. An editorial review or control of the content provided in the internet is rather limited and usually has no effect. There's virtually no censorship in the internet. For these structural reasons, the internet is the ideal platform for the dissemination of cultural marginalized information, heterodox interpretations, and differing descriptions of reality. This creates the possibility of an open-ended competition between orthodox and heterodox reality concepts, including conspiracy theories, which remained largely excluded in the traditional mass media-dominated public. Altogether, these factors create conspirational interpretation of current or historical decisions, events, and processes. They also decide on the position on the above outlined continuum between orthodox and heterodox conspiracy theory of a particular conspiracy theory to a concrete historical moment. In this context, it's difficult to weigh the mentioned theoretical determinants. Which factor may play a dominant role and how the interaction of the different factors is can only be answered empirically for individual cases of conspiracy theories. In summary, the model presented suggests a critical but open examination of the contents of conspiracy theories without an over-hasty condemnation. This means that conspiracy theories should not be studied in terms of their in terms of their dangerous potential, but also according to emancipatory potential. This argument is the more weight, the more uniform and formed the orthodox reality of a society is. In scientific terms, the aim is to present an alternative theoretical model for understanding the conspiracy thinking in our present society from a perspective based on sociology of knowledge, and to include conspiracy theories into the set of recognized object of scientific research. That conspiracy theories in this way would perhaps not be as scandalous as before is a risk that I like to accept, and I think open democracies should accept it too. Thanks for your attention.
So nobody is able anymore to investigate CIA in a rational way. discredit the work of those who investigate in that fashion and not rethink that.
Yes, thank you. I think this is a problem related to the term conspiracy theories or conspiracy theorists. In reality, it's a huge spectrum between nonsense, really nonsense, that is also communicated with no scientific forms and arguments, and the other side of the spectrum are investigative journalists. And so I think it's very difficult to describe conspiracy theories as a category or conspiracy theorists as specific people with specific forms of thinking. And what I try is to give a usual and a definition that is not a priori pathologizing or problematizing conspiracy theories or conspiracy thinking, but just to try to describe it as a special form of knowledge that can be problematic, sure. And if somebody has a conspiracy theory and is not able to reflect his positions and to be open for arguments, that's problematic, sure. But that's not an inherent factor of conspiracy thinking, of conspiracy theories. I think the main factor is how people are believing in conspiracy theories. Some of them are very open, are making conspiracy theories like scientific theories, and are open for opposing arguments, and others not. So this is a huge spectrum. As I said, what I tried was to find a definition of what includes this whole spectrum of different opinions and structures of communication, forms of communication, but to have a general definition. I hope I answered your question. Okay. The other point is, and I think that's one of the objective facts. Believers or scientists that are discussing about conspiracy theories always argument with facts. But what is a fact? I mean, for example, in the 9/11 discussion, there are discussions about how the Twin Towers broke together, what was the reason, and there are scientists on both sides of the discussion. So it's very difficult to decide for normal people what fact is real. And I think another important factor is that you cannot understand conspiracy theories without thinking about real conspiracy. Especially in American culture, where we had conspiracies like Watergate scandal, etc., people were confronted with conspiracies all the time in the culture. So it's a model of thinking what is very present in Europe too. We had this example for shifting from a heterodox conspiracy theory to an orthodox conspiracy theory in a very small time in Germany, in the so-called Third Reich. The conspiracy theory of Jewish Bolshevik conspiracy that was heterodox. I would say what is heterodox, and as Hitler came, in a few years it came to an orthodox conspiracy theory. Or another example, the Snowden case, the NSA scandal. There was some conspiracy theory about this. It was a heterodox conspiracy theory. You could read about it in the internet and in books, but it was heterodox. And then came Snowden, and from one day to the other, this conspiracy theory came to an orthodox conspiracy theory. And I think that this is a very interesting case to look at what are the factors that change a conspiracy theory from heterodox to orthodox.
Also from my side, first of all, thanks for a very enlightening presentation. I really like your point about not being able to make general statements about conspiracy theories, because I think they're just too diverse. There's such a vast array of different versions of conspiracy theoretical thinking. And I also want to mention the NSA scandal that you did now. The TTIP negotiations could be another example where everything is made in secret and it's issues that concern our really daily lives and democratic institutions also, which are in danger, and they're being held in secret, and our governments are concealing information from us, and now they have been leakages of information, and yeah, how do you classify that? And for me also, another distinction that I would propose that might make things clearer in one way, would be that derived from our empirical analysis that AMIR and me did, which we're going to present in a minute. That distinction would be to distinguish, on the one hand, conspiracy theories, general ones, and then on the other hand, more radical and xenophobic ones. So where a specific group, ethnic group usually, is devalued, and I think there you have to draw a line. Heterodox and orthodox, it's just maybe set them apart because they're really dangerous and can lead to things as you mentioned just with Hitler and the Third Reich. So I think that this distinction might make sense in general to use it and then afterwards apply the different categories. What do you think?
Yes, thank you. This is a good idea. I think it's important to understand which political ideologies or religious beliefs or whatever belief systems are in the background of conspiracy theories, but I think in some cases it is difficult to analyze such a category like political ideology or clever to think about this, like, okay, there could be a conspiracy, and I think this is very makes sense, but you have to be I think not behind every conspiracy theory is a category like in specific political thinking or something.
Yeah. Okay. Actually, I was making two points. So the first one was that there are real conspiracies out there, and the second one to make another distinction apart from that. So I agree with the NSA. That was I really maybe this distinction between conspiracy hypothesis might be valuable there, where it's still open and discussable, and there's not this completely dualistic worldview derived from it, and which goes into the direction of really good versus evil stories. So the second part of the ideological and xenophobic and radical worldview behind it was not concerning the NSA, but rather concerning really xenophobic conspiracy theories.
Perhaps we have time for just one last question, and I think it was Amir's chance.
Just a quick comment. We thanked you during the coffee breaks for your work, because it was also influential for our research. But just to say that someone made the point, I think it was you, Dr. Thomas, that there's something of a strategic malevolence maybe behind conspiracy theories, but I think we shouldn't state this as being implicit, because I think there are loads of followers within conspiracy theories that are just gullible and that take this as is without questioning it further, or even lacking the skills to question it further. But to imply a strategic malevolence, we have to be, I think, careful of that.
Okay, thank you very much. If there are not any more comments to this concrete issue, perhaps you can switch to the next presentation of Hamdi DIZDAREVIĆ and SAMAN HAMDI. Both are preparing their master degree or PhD at Potsdam University in Roman studies, and they also participated to the first conference in Potsdam, and now they're presenting, I suppose, the second part of the presentation regarding right-wing movements in Germany. So I'm looking forward to it, and thank you very much for the presentation already now. I have to switch computers.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you for the intro, but we need a little bit of time to set up our equipment. First of all, also, we would like to thank everybody for being here and for having us talk here. We really enjoy the city, Turin is super nice, and your hospitality is great. So thanks a lot, Massimo, also. Then just as kind words, let's get to the topic.
Okay, so thank you very much for having us. This is SAMAN HAMDI, I'm the DIZDAREVIĆ, and we're a research group gathered around Professor Kimminich from the University of Potsdam, and we did a case study for the last conference about right-wing movements in Germany. And we looked at two different authors that sort of agree with those movements or either support them with their work. So today we're going to look at only one of those, and you can sort of guess from the title we're going to do. It's called From Germanization to Islamization to Americanization: How a Conspiracy Theorist Sides with Different Movements. So we're going to have a look at Jürgen Elsässer, who is a author who, within the last 20 years, changed from the radical left to the radical right. So we're going to tell you a bit about him and about the theoretical framework that we're going to use, about the data set as well, and we're going to do a little analysis and give you our ideas about it. Jürgen Elsässer is a journalist. In the 1990s, he he's been sort of the one of the progenitors and activists in the radical left, namely in the branch that's called the anti-Deutsch or the anti-Germans. We're going to explain in a bit what this entails. And he's seen a radical shift of political views and is today in the new right movements. So, and he supports movements like, for example, Pegida, which means patriotic Europeans against the Islamization of the Occident, and other right-wing movements, but also movements critical of America and capitalism as well.
Okay, so for our analysis, we'll proceed as follows. So first of all, we have a signification analysis where we use a model made or proposed by Madison. We'll explain it in a minute. Then we'll have a logical rhetorical analysis, which will be Amir's part. I will do number one. And for the overall presentation, we'll use a modeling model developed. We'll use a modeling model developed by our dear Professor Kimminich here. And us, we'll explain it also in a minute, and overall we'll compare three texts. Okay, so our data set consists of the following three texts. The first one is an article from As This Has Left This Past, as Ami mentioned, from the anti-German movement. And there the major threat is seen as a Germanization of Europe. And it's funny because this Germanization switches throughout the years to another issue. So the second article is 15 years later and of February of this year, and it's called Terror Target Europe, and it's from Atlas's own magazine, the Comic magazine, and this one is in the social movement context of the Pegida movement, and here the major threat is seen as the Islamization of Europe. And the third one stems from a speech he gave at Victory in Europe Day in front of the Central Station in Berlin. In May 2015, in front of a neo-Nazi Reichsbürger crowd, so another social movement context, and there the major threat is seen as the Americanization. So you can see the thread already, how he develops his thoughts throughout the years. And it's going to be interesting.
Yeah. So, we've come up with a sort of theoretical framework together as a research group that consists of so-called modules. And I'm not going to dwell too much on presentation because Professor Kimminich is going to explain this in details theoretically. Suffice it to say that these modules sort of function like Lego bricks. You can stack Lego bricks together, the entire construct doesn't have to make sense, but it holds up. So basically, you can think of conspiracy theories as a sort of diffuse water bubble that you can kind of put these modules in. And they have, as Lego bricks do, sort of small meeting points. And those meeting points kind of function like the highlighting hiding theory, where you basically pick up things that suit you. For instance, you take something like the Nazi regime, and then you say a sentence like, Hitler built many motorways in Germany, so he must be a good guy. And you hide all the rest of the nasty things that go together with World War II. And then you dock it onto maybe a left-wing model and you say, that sounds kind of socialist. So you combine two different ideological things together because they have small meeting points that fit, and you can put it in a context like a conspiracy theory.
Okay, so the theoretical framework proposed by Madison is based on basic distinctions between mythological type of consciousness by Uri Lordmann and logical type of consciousness. And the way we're talking about rather radical conspiracy theories here, and the way these are framed is by the co-text, which poses as the meta-narrative, so the basic narrative of the conspiracy, which you see on the outer circle, and then you have the mythological logic on the left and the descriptive logic on the right. We're going to have a look in detail into them. So the mythological logic of signification is very archaic. It's got the sacral order as transcultural metatext, meaning that it's this ancient fight between good and evil, always inscribed into the story. It always builds on cultural memory and sees the world as one of homomorphic resemblances. And it is semantic. So everything that we see in the world carries meaning and is a sign that points to the greater conspiracy on this side. And the enemy image, which goes together with this, is the enemy is not home. So here the enemy is seen as being on the outside. It is evil, it is chaotic, it is not structured, it's very unpredictable, and it's anti-individualist, which means that even if one individual is positioned within the narrative, this individual only always represents the attributes of the larger collective, and it's one-dimensional. And the other side, the descriptive logic of signification, is rather contradictory, but they're bound together by this code text. And so it's using meta-languages such as cause and effect, chronology, logic. It's very deterministic, so everything that happens, happens for a reason. And it's got this pseudo-scientific logic of signification, so sources are referenced, statistics are used, numerical data is being presented. And it's also marked by a hunt for contradictions in official accounts. So mass media are always criticized for being contradictory in themselves. And the enemy image which goes together with this is the enemy as anti-home, which is very different from the enemy as non-home. So it's also on the outside, but it's actually a reverse mirror image of the self. So it's highly structured, it's got this hierarchic system of the string pullers and the ones carrying out the actual conspiracy. And we have different subsystems, and the deeds are always systematic, so they're not evil in themselves, but they follow a certain interest. And the conspirators are always presented as these kind of amoral superheroes.
So we're having a look at that data set right now. We started the first analysis, and this is from a collection of articles that the European system published for the Concrete magazine. Concrete magazine was a anti-German magazine, which he published for a long time, and then was kicked out of it because he changed his ideology. The collection is called "Had the Führer Lived to See This?" And the article is called "Germanization of Europe." Germanization is the key word here, and so to say, the main culprit in this story. Behind this stands, of course, the anti-German movement, which is an offspring from the traditional left in Germany. After the reunification, there was a fear in certain radical left-wing groups that Germans might revert to this kind of anti-Semitist worldview and the Nazi ideology that was present before. And so they had a fear of a certain fourth Reich, so to speak. And inherent in the anti-German movement is the idea of the German guilt due to the Holocaust. So this is kind of an axiom for them, in which they unequivocally support Israel as a state. And of course, every other partner state that warrants the sovereignty of Israel, for instance, the US. And within supporting the US, they're not really that critical of American capital and capitalism in general. So they're in a stark contrast to traditional left-wing context.
Yeah, so in analyzing this text, the code text, so the meta-narrative, goes as follows, so that the German foreign policy and all the politicians of Germany are manipulated by the German capital, and they both are using and have been using throughout the last 100 years German nationalism to carry out the Germanization of Europe. And they do so via two lines, according to Elsesser in the 90s. First, the line of economic interpenetration, and secondly, annexation by force. Even though these seem contradictory, he says that if number one doesn't work, then number two is applied. So the reunification was because, or happened because economic interpenetration with the GDR wasn't possible, for example, he's saying. That's the point he's making. Okay, so, and the mythological side to it is that we have again this thing of homomorphic resemblances. So he basically equates all of the politicians of the last 100 years and says they're all equal. So the German foreign policy versus two lines since the times of the German Kaiserreich. And what he does also is that he equates all the German politicians with the Nazis and says even today's politicians are following the same kind of ideology. So this quote is, the strategy of annexation was pursued by politicians such as Ludendorff and the Altdeutschen in the first or pre-World War II or pre-Nazi era. Later it was the Nazis, today it's the German national current in and outside of the CDU-CSU. So he equates the Christian Democrats and conservatives in Germany with the Nazis, basically. And the descriptive logic is that there's this hierarchy between the German capital and the politicians. So for the first line, for example, he gives the following quote. The first line of economic penetration was embodied by politicians such as in World War I, Naumann, Lothar Stresemann, and the reunification of Genscher. So we can see they're all just representing the larger collective again. And behind this line, so the hierarchy of the string pullers, stands the capital ready for the world market and able to compete globally, electrical and chemical industries. And what's interesting here is that he's only positioning German capital as evil, and he's even mentioning US capital and Western capital as serving good interests within Europe. And so there's no systemic understanding of capitalism as such. And the input and the mission statement is clearly those of the anti-Deutschen. And the only chance to weaken German nationalism, in his view, is by criticizing and taking sides with the Western Allied forces and criticizing German nationalism as good as possible. And in another text in the same book, he's saying, enough with the paralyzing alliance policies, enough with the boring demonstrations, a small radical minority needs different forms of action. So he demands a splinter group within the left, which closes itself off from the rest, which is very different from what he demands today.
So on the surface level, I tried to make out certain tropes and also maybe ideological a few things that might point us in the direction of conspiracy theories. The problem with this was that in the first text he uses very few tropes. Now this might be due to the medium as such, because it's an article that's supposed to be very scientific, but of course there's no citation or anything. But on the other hand, there are some tropes like the metaphor of the renaissance of national economy and politics, and there are ironic title references to writing literature like Germanity Awake, which he uses ironically to then talk about the same literature. Very important are the three rhetorical questions that he poses. In question one, he basically says, that imperialist politics, he means the pure annexation strategies that Germany used prior to World War I, are anachronic. And he says this by using the German metaphor Mottenkiste. So Mottenkiste is something, literally translated moth box. So if you know moths from cupboards, when you put something into a cupboard and you don't use it for a long time, then the moths eat it. Per se, you don't need it anymore. And so, in question two, I put this on the logical level, he posits that economic penetration is probably, for this cause, which he criticizes, better for Germany than the previous one. So Germany, in his eyes, there's this fear that Germany will always try to dominate someone economically and fail to do so, happen by annexation. In the third question, he asks whether Germany's global interests are better served within the EU. So, as long as Germany is supposedly using the EU as a tool to construct to achieve those goals, and he uses the cynic dog of Maastricht as an expression for the EU. He also has some circular logic, like saying, well, if Germany, because a part of this text is also the fact that Germany is supposedly helping smaller nations to become independent, like ex-Yugoslav states or Czechoslovakia, in order to then be this kind of benevolent nationalist force. And so if Germany attests the right to nations to do so, why wouldn't the other nations attest the same right to Germany to be a strong nation wants to have this kind of imperialist path? We're coming to the second text. It's 20 years later, and it's from his own magazine called Compact, which is kind of a conspiracy theory magazine, and the text is called Terror Target Europe, and the main issue here is Islamization. One of the important movements here is Pegida. Pegida stands for Patriotic Europeans Against the Islamization of the Occident, which is sort of a movement that sprang from several crises, several economic crises that happened after unification, especially, and lastly the crisis that we're talking about today. And authors like Tilo Sarrazin, you can see him in the top right, abused this kind of state to talk about the alleged Islamization, silent Islamization of Europe. He claims that in 4 to 5 generations, due to demographic reasons, Muslims will be the majority in Germany, and Germany will be silently Islamized. The media have also played a great role in disseminating these ideas, like in the Spiegel, titles like these that say Mecca Germany is silent Islamization. And so Pegida is basically something that sprang from such a mindset.
Yeah, and the context he has within this text of his, so the basic narrative of the conspiracy, there he posits that the US and the UK, together with their secret services, planned from the long hand the attacks on Charlie Hebdo, and formed the union with the Islamist terrorists in general and with Islamist forces in the world to weaken the patriotic nations within Europe in the global fight for power. So there's this clear interest behind the US supporting terrorism. The mythological logic side to it is he's using bit different to the development from the last text. He's using a lot of Christian imagery. So, for example, he's talking about the most sinister response of Islamism supported by the Anglo-American secret services, the most sinister response of Sunnism, and he also makes out the relationship between the British secret service and Islamists, and has a subtitle in the text called A Deal with the Devil. He also says that they see the Faustian deal, so even high culture is referenced. And secondly, for the descriptive logic, again, this hierarchy, he makes it very elegantly with a picture composition on his pages. So, for example, on the two pages on the left, you have pictures of the British Secret Service. One is James Bond from the Skyfall movie, where the MI6 is basically shown as corrupt. And the other one is MI6 headquarters. And below, you have two terrorists, so one of the brothers, the Charlie Hebdo attacks, and the other one is their mentor, who basically watched over them. So you have the street pullers on top, the carriers out, so there are the people who carry it out below, and in this line, again, there's a reformulation on the bottom of the code text, so it's really interesting how he positions these things. And just showing the sheer amount of subdivisions of the two collectives within the conspirers, under number one, you have members of the Anglo-American conspirators and string pullers, so such as Anglo-American secret services. And under number two, we have members of the Islamist recipients of orders and the Sunni supporters. So for example, the brothers Kouachi, and you can see the list is endless, so he's basically playing with all these categories the whole time. And the in-group and the mission statement he's concluding with is his last subtitle is The Patriot's Moment. So he calls for Pegida to step up and rise to the challenge. And the goal of the conspiracy, again, he formulates as frightening and breaking resistance against the further Islamization of Europe. This resistance is, of course, Pegida. And in another historic metaphor he gives on his homepage, he equates all the enemies of Pegida, so the large parties, churches, labor unions, etc., with the ancien regime. So he's saying basically Pegida represents what the French Revolution was when it came up. So it's going to overthrow and start a basic democratic movement in the whole of Europe. It's going to spring new movements like this all over.
So this text, in compared to the last one, is much more building week. So there are many more metaphors and other tropes that are used. I'm going to speed this up a bit, fortunately, because of time constraints. So metaphors like the darkest forms of Islamism that we've heard before, or parent-child relationships, like the Islamic State is a foster child of the US, or the US nourishes small Sunni groups for their cause. Very interesting is this metaphorical expression he's using. So he's repeating in one section, it is proven that so and so, and it is proven that so and so. Repeating this, he creates a dramatic effect, but also he uses the passive construction in German as well, which kind of is a delegation of proof. So if I express something in a passive voice, I don't have to prove it, and since it's written in a passive voice, I don't have to state who proved it. Very kind. So on a logical level, he, for instance, makes out this dichotomy of the pious Sunni who are more prone to Wahhabism, Salafism, and other forms of extremism, whereas the westernized and the Shia in general are different to him. Then again, interestingly, the Shiites are automatically not pious or non-pious, they're just there within the non-pious group. And then he contradicts himself by saying to lose oneself in religious niceties would not be very enlightened. Just to change the topic and go over something else. Okay, so the third text is actually a speech, and it was given on the 9th of May. You've probably noticed that usually in Germany you celebrate the 8th of May as Victory Day, but he's celebrating the 9th of May, which is actually the Russian Victory Day, because at the time the message of victory reached Russia later, so they celebrate the 9th. And he's gathering a crowd of neo-Nazi supporters and also Reichsbürger, as we'll explain in a bit. And he seeks a union with patriots from Europe, pro-Putin supporters, but more specifically the pro-Putin bikers called the Night Wolves, which at the time were forbidden to enter Germany to support him. Okay, so the Reichsbürger are not really a formal group, they're more like a conspiracy theory, you could say. They claim that Germany is de facto not an international country, an internationally recognized country. And it's still actually behind the scenes controlled by the Allied forces, and that it's actually still the German Empire that's occupied by the Allies, and it kind of functions like a company.
So the context he makes up in this speech he gives is that basically it's the US left behind the financial capital, basically a context for Jewish world conspiracy in a sense, and they are the string pullers and they control the German government in line with this Reichsbürger ideology, and they conspire against the patriotic self-determination and union of German and Russian people by keeping Germany an occupied country and causing, now it's interesting because he's combining everything, Islamization, Israelization, and first and foremost, Americanization of Europe. Okay, the Germanization is out of the box because it's completely the reverse image now, but he actually combines these three, and on the mythological side, he uses, for example, anti-Semitic modules. So, for example, talking about the NSA, he's using the image of a Kraken. Kraken has a planet in its group with the help of Google and other internet giants and prepares it for the blows of the American military. Or he's using an anti-Semitic Fed module which is also very common within this right-wing context in Germany. On the descriptive logic side, and the enemy is anti-Ohm, he's interrupting himself during the speech, so he says, I see here the red lacquered fascists of the hypocritical Antifa, the anti-fascists, that what we in any case do not need are these storm troops of the international financial capital. So basically he's saying, which is another conspiracy theory in the right-wing context, that the Antifa is controlled by the financial capital and the Jewish world conspiracy. And we will not stand by and observe how Shotgun Uschi, German Minister of Defense, Ursula von der Leyen, is again sending our sons and daughters to Stalingrad to die there. This time it's ordered by Monsanto and Exxon for the profits of American genetics and oil industries. Interesting also, because this time around it's the US corporations which are evil, and he's even mentioning the good German enterprises which are spied on by the NSA. And the in-group, of course, is the people he talks to, as usual. Here it is, he claims his goal as a national front. We can also call it queer front, which is kind of third position politics, as it should represent the cross-section of the populace. And he also mentions again this union between Berlin and Moscow, since he adheres to the kind of spin doctor of Putin, Alexander Dugin, and his ideology of Eurasian powers uniting against transatlantic powers.
So, and as any speech, this one is much more abundant with tropes as the text, of course. But the I have to admit, these images were quite disgusting in a way. So things like what Saman already mentioned, Shotgun Uschi is sending his sons and daughters to die in Stalingrad again. And there's loads of allusions to World War II, to Cold War, terms like, in West Germany, there was this term like German-American and French-American friendship. He says German-Russian friendship. And so, weaponry as well. And it was interesting that the audience already knew about what a Katyushka rocket launcher is, which in German is called Stalinorgel. So, Stalin's organ, organ in the sense, instrument. So allegedly, claims, well, the Nazis couldn't enter because the Germans didn't have mounted guns to gun us down. And then he says, patriots of all countries unite, which is an allusion to workers of the world unite, which in the German literally is workers of all countries unite. And he also references the expression, we are the people, which was the demonstration cry of GDR citizens during loads of metaphors, unfortunately, I don't have the time to go into them. So, at the logical level, again, circulatory logic. So, President Gauck is visiting Soviet war memorials, but why is he doing this if he agitates war against Russia, for instance? Or the entry of Germany is allowed to people like Pussy Riot, but not in the night walks and so forth.
So, concerning our summary, here again we have the three texts and the three major threats on top. So, Germanization in 1990 or later on, and Islamization and Americanization in 2015. And they're connected to specific conspirators and enemy images. So, for Germanization, it's the German capital who control German politicians. For Islamization, it's the Anglo-American forces that control the Islamists. And for Americanization, it's the financial US capital and the transatlantic powers which control inter-alia, the German government, and the Antifa. And the commonalities of these three texts is that there's a very high agency theoretical orientation. So there's no structures, no system being referenced in any way. He uses absolute social categories, so it's never an in-between or a differentiation, it's always good or bad. And he uses a lot of Nazi references, and which is also, what's also interesting is that within the anti-Deutsche movement, there's also kind of an Islamophobic tendency, and that's also a recurring element throughout the three movements and texts. And the development is interesting, maybe also due to the media itself and the crowd he's talking to, since his populism increases over time vastly, and the conspiracy theoretical modules he uses, they grow, so he uses a lot more in the later texts than before, and the mythological aspects also grow, so he uses a lot more good and evil imagery in the later texts, and the tropes, in the beginning they're very sparse, and they're also increasing over time, so they're very abundant in the last part. And our conclusions are that, first of all, we don't want to completely overgeneralize, and we also think that the rhetoric depends on social medium and context. That's why we went so much into the socio-historical context. And what I mentioned before is that Elsesser clings to this very dualistic worldview, and which we think is a sign of radical conspiracy theories, and which might make sense in distinguishing different types of conspiracy theories. And even though his worldviews and his political convictions shift, he still clings to the same narrative structures. And that's interesting because as long as the narrative structures remain, these modules are very interchangeable in the end. So it doesn't matter whether it's German or the US capital behind it, as long as there's somebody behind it. The final distinction I mentioned already, this collective devaluing of specific social outgroups, hate speech and racism, that sets very dangerous conspiracy theories apart. So that's our conclusions. Thank you for your attention, and we're happy about questions or comments.
So thank you very much, Ami and Saman, for this wonderful introduction to also the ambiguous person of Elsesser, who depicts the blurry character of current conspiracy theories in Germany. I think also regarding this notion of radical conspiracy theory, there might be any questions or comments, so please feel welcome to say something. Yes, Mr.
I think it was a fascinating paper, also because it shows another element that I think is very interesting in conspiracy theories, which is the construction, I would call it extraction of macro agents or macro agencies. So what does it mean to say that Germany wants this, Germany wants that, United States wants that? I mean, United States is a history of many governments with different presidents, very complex bureaucracies, personalities that are very various. From this point of view, conspiracy theories work as shortcuts for the comprehension of a complex political world, but of course they are false shortcuts. They don't seem to lead anyway in terms of actual comprehension of what is going on. This is the first comment that is a comment that I offer also as a question. And the second one is that there is in Europe, I think, at least not in the United States, but in Europe, space for entrepreneurship of conspiracy. I mean, it would be interesting to, as journalists say, to follow money. Like how much money is made out of conspiracy theories, and what would these people do without conspiracy theories? Without selling these books, selling gadgets, and so on and so forth. In Italy, the leader of the Five Stars Movement political party has the most popular blog in Italy, and is also a constant source of income, for instance. So this economic aspect of conspiracy theories should be investigated.
Thank you for your comments. I had an anecdote to tell. When we were doing the seminar, we were also looking at a economic conspiracy theorist, and his book basically had a voucher for a seminar, so you could get 50% off the next seminar if you bought the book. So, and Elsesser is actually doing the same. His magazine is surprising for a magazine to have the same aesthetics overall. So every article is carefully visually crafted, and as we've shown, the hierarchy exists in every single page. There are motifs of peace stuffs and whatnot. And then at the end, you always have advertisement for a DVD from this conference or whatever. So it was almost too easy to depart that one.
Yeah.
I think you point to a very important point about conspiracy theories, point of simplification, and very over-determining factors within their narrative structures. On the other hand, I think, as we've said before, that real conspiracies have existed throughout time, and it's also important to not fall into this line of using conspiracy theories as a mode of silencing, or this attribute mode of silencing actual critique, because I think even though like American governments have differed over time and have different orientations, you can still make up commonalities and could have, for example, a systemic or imperialist critique of how the US governments in the last decades have acted. So, but I agree, this oversimplification is completely it's not discussable at all. Yeah, and about this money issue, it's very interesting because he also always, in his, he's got a YouTube channel of the Compact magazine, and he's always mentioning how the tides are rising of his consumers and his readers. He says, oh no, we're at 30,000 people having bought the magazine last month. And I think it's got like two sides. On the one hand, he's making money off of it. On the other hand, it's also suggesting that since the group is growing, there's some legitimacy to it. And it's hard to make out actually what his motives are. I think we cannot completely do it. It's not, we don't have the methods to extract it, but I think it might play a role if he's got his own magazine and is built mainly on conspiracy theoretical logic, can be sold.
We had this aspect already in the first session in Potsdam when we were looking to Dirk Müller's conspiracy theories, which was dealt, and he's somebody working at the stock master, so he's very well known, and he's also called Mr. Dax, and he's selling several books, and he's also offering, when you buy a book, that you have something like a boucher, and you can take part in his sessions where he's even explaining how you can better invest your money. So there is a combination of selling knowledge. In this case, it's knowledge, because he is a banker and he has experience, but at the same time, he's using his knowledge for conspiracy thinking and for explaining how the European crisis is ruining Europe. So I think this might be an interesting question also for internet and Facebook. If there also, for Facebook, is something which you can make a lot of money with clicks with it. So maybe that thing we have to think about.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think it's a very interesting point, actually, this profit aspect. And then again, I think it might not be like a characteristic that's only within conspiracy theories, because knowledge is sold in general. And but maybe it's interesting to see whether there are distinctions between more classical forms of knowledge and these really radical conspiracy theoretical forms. He actually, because a lot of the right-wing media now, they found old articles of his and made them public, and digital is he, and on his webpage he's explaining that even today he's neither left nor right, it's a front third position politics he's advocating, and he's explaining that only after the Iraq war and after the American foreign policy acts of the last few years, it's possible for him to take this position of today. And back then, this position he took with the anti-Deutschen, with the anti-Germans, was the position to take at the moment, but now, since all this has changed so drastically, this is his explanation, of course. It's,
The thing is, with the first text, we had huge problems finding anything on the internet about his leftist past. That's one danger of the internet forgets too quickly. And that's something that we're going to have to deal with in the future. If it hadn't been for libraries, we wouldn't have found the text.
Are there any other questions, comments? If not, I have one question for you, which is getting back a little bit to the presentation of Andreas Anton also. For me, it's like, perhaps you can outline this question of tactical use of conspiracy theories, which we have seen also in the presentation before, or in the questions regarding this presentation, and now in your presentation it's becoming very visible, because we are also talking about capitalization. Which is interesting for me also when we're speaking about radical conspiracy theories, is this kind of meta level they are gaining. They are not only addressing their content, they are not only using a rhetorical form, but they also use those reflections about suggesting that we have 400,000 followers, or that they say that we are speaking for the German people, we are the 99%, if we want to go to leftist discourses also. So I think this is a crucial point, because then we have, it's difficult to speak about heterodox and orthodox knowledge, and it's difficult to speak about the verification characteristics of conspiracy theories, but we have to talk about tactical use of those genres, if you want to, of communication. And this is also a point where it's getting really dangerous, because they can always react and like try to find that place between all those blurry sides of communication they're using. So perhaps you have some idea on this question about like the meta level addressees of this communication. Who are they, 99% or 1%?
I think it depends on who's using what, whether it's dangerous or not. But yeah, it's a very interesting aspect. You're mentioning like strategic use, and even within the left there's this discussion about it that usually the populism is left to the right wing movements, and so they get all the easy voters, and it's Ernesto Laclau and Chantal Mouffe who are calling for this populist left movement, because we're losing the people to the right wing context and xenophobic, and it's getting dangerous. And for me, this 99% is clearly a strategic usage, and also one strategic usage to change the conversation in the US specifically, since it goes back to Joseph Stiglitz, Keynesian economist. It's a little bit pointing to the injustices we have in our economic system. So for me, that's more legitimate strategic use of such a category. I don't see so much of a danger in there, because it points out a problem that if you don't address it, it's going to be far more dangerous, the growing inequalities in our world today. The Oxfam report of this year says that the richest 1% next year is going to own more than half of what the rest of the world, the 99%, are owning. And I mean, the injustices are blatant and growing in the world today. So for me, that's the danger rather lies in not pointing out this, this opposition and these interests. So for me, really, the danger lies when it gets to xenophobic and very racist parts. And there I would make a distinction also between leftist populism and rightist populism, because right-wing populists who want to abolish a certain part of the population, and the other one want to change them or like create a new society. Of course, you have also stupid left-wing populists. But yeah, in general, I would rather make up two different tendencies within them.
Regarding the meta language question, firstly, we can see, because it's a kind of diachronic research, so we can see that in the first example, he doesn't really need much of the meta language, because I think it hasn't been the practice yet to use meta language so abundantly as it is today. The last example was from a YouTube channel. So you have all these constructs like a catchy title, all the following comments from people and so forth. And I also think that we have to separate the rhetorical level as a meta language in itself. So all the illusions that he's using to always this, well, we still haven't settled something. So it is part of the narrative, but it's so conscious and it's so present that I can't help but think of it as him having this as a certain meta narrative. It concerns us all, including the Germans, and we have to deal with this. So I think it would be very, very important to analyze Herzl's from his point of view, to see how he uses Facebook, how he uses YouTube, how he uses Twitter, if he uses, I don't know, look at his Twitter account. And how he uses this in a magazine as well. The magazine that he publishes looks more like a Facebook page than a normal magazine.
If there are no other questions or comments, I feel that the lunch break is approaching. If I'm well informed, we're going to meet again at 3 p.m.
Yeah.
Here.
Yes.
So enjoy your lunch.